It's such an honor to be here. I want to talk about social media, but I'm going to talk mostly about Facebook since it is the most important social medium in the world. I've got a lot to say. I've promised that I will finish no later than 2:30. And I thought what made the most sense was I'd go for about 2 hours, we'd take a lunch break, and then come back and do another hour and a half. Sound good? That is a joke. All right, let's get started. On last November 24th, the lead editorial in the New York Times had the headline, "Do we have a moral obligation to leave Facebook?" This is what it's come to. It may turn out that of the big four, Amazon, Google, Facebook, and Apple, Facebook may be the first of the four to fail. It's facing an existential threat, a threat entirely of its own making, based on greed, arrogance, hubris, and negligence. It's really remarkable how fast it has fallen. But if you look at the beginning of Facebook, the urban legend, I'm not sure it's true, was that Mark Zuckerberg started Facebook at the Harvard campus to get girls. But whether that's true or not, he really did have a vision of connecting the whole world, of everybody being able to find each other. And the mantra of Facebook in its earliest days was move fast and break things. And indeed, they did move fast. 15 years ago, to be on Facebook, you had to have a harvard.edu email address. Today, 2.4 billion people out of 7 billion people on the planet, or about 34%, are on Facebook. But it's actually much more impressive than that, because 1.3 billion people, the Chinese, can't get Facebook. So really, Facebook's reaching 2.4 out of 5.7 billion people on the planet, or 44%. But it's even more impressive than that, because of the 5.7 billion people, that includes non-users of the internet. It turns out on planet Earth, there are about 3.4 billion people who have the internet and don't live in China. And of those 3.4 billion, 2.4 billion of them are on Facebook, or about 65%. And incidentally, Facebook isn't happy with that 65%. In August of 2016, Elon Musk's company, SpaceX, was about to launch a rocket that blew up at Cape Canaveral on the launch pad. And while Musk was embarrassed, the person who was really outraged was Mark Zuckerberg, because on top of that rocket was a satellite designed to go over India and bring Facebook to one of the few parts of the world they didn't have much penetration, and it takes about 2 years to replace satellites. Also, showing how much he's trying to improve his 65% reach to that 1.3 billion people who are not on Facebook in China. He was in China about 4 years ago. If you haven't seen this, you should go to YouTube. It's pretty remarkable. And he spoke at a conference of about 2,000 people, and his speech was translated into Mandarin. And then they got to a question and answer period, and as the question was about to be translated for him, he waved his hands and answered in Mandarin. He had secretly been learning Mandarin, his wife is Chinese, but it was really great theater. But that 1.3 billion who are not on Facebook sort of drives them crazy. Facebook has grown so fast, it shown little regard for the veracity or accuracy of the information on its pages. It's shown little inclination to check on that quality. The only thing they seem to have cared about over the last 5 years is, does the check clear? And it certainly didn't bother them, even if the check was in rubles. Last year, I was at a conference where Keith Weed, the chief marketing officer of Unilever, the second biggest advertiser on the planet, Keith out and out threatened Facebook, saying, if you don't ensure that my advertising dollars don't end up on websites filled with hate speech, terrorism, racism, I'm going to pull every dollar off of Facebook. Finally, they listened. That was the message, not the message from critics or journalists, but advertisers threatening to pull their money. Facebook, and really all social media, takes power that had been in the hands of government or media and moves it to crowd control. And in that process, it weakens traditional media. One of the big advertising holding companies came out with a remarkable number last year that showed that between 2000 and 2018, 45% of all advertising was sucked out of radio, television, newspapers, and magazines, and ended up in two places, Facebook and Google. Social media has really decimated the economic foundation of journalism across most of the world. Now, one of the positive things we saw about digital when it really began around the turn of the century was the idea, a really exciting idea, that anybody can be a journalist. And what was exciting about that was, in a world where the press was controlled by too few people, by governments or by billionaires, and there was very little access, this meant it could be opened up. Everybody would have a camera in their cell phone, everybody could take video, the power of police and repressive governments could be minimized or overturned. The notion that anyone could be a journalist was exciting. Now we're seeing the downside of anyone can be a journalist. We're realizing the real advantage of professional training for journalists, accreditation, quality, standards, editing, all of which have disappeared. One of the things we've learned in the work I do, which is really pretty interesting, is that Westerners are not very good at distinguishing good information from bad. It turns out we never had to be, because most of our professional media, with exceptions, was pretty good. In America, we tended to judge the quality of media by how good it looked, which isn't that bad a measure. 20 years ago, to create a magazine that looked like Time magazine cost tens of millions of dollars. Today, to create a website that looks like the New York Times costs nothing. It turns out in our global work, the Chinese were much better than Americans or Europeans at distinguishing good information from bad, not because they're smarter than we are, but they've never been able to trust their media. From the time they were little, they would read something in the paper or see something on television, and they would have to apply the test, who's saying that? What's their agenda? Can I believe it? They developed skills out of necessity. We didn't have those skills. We went online not able to distinguish good information from bad and got burned. Because social media has put disinformation into hyperspeed. you heard some really interesting cases yesterday. Let me share one that particularly scares me. In my work in media, I talk a lot about 5G. I think 5G is a really big deal. The mistake most people make with 5G is they think 5G is to 4G as 4G was to 3G, which means that it'll make the apps on their phone move a little faster, and it will. But 5G is the first wireless technology that's so fast, the distinction between wired and wireless disappears. We're not going to talk that way anymore. And 5G enables driverless cars, what I think is the most important innovation of the next 30 years, telesurgery. It allows movies to be downloaded in seconds. It changes everything. It's a really powerful technology. Well, earlier this year on RT, Russia Today, as I think all of you know, a channel owned by the Russians, but not designed for Russians in America or Australia or Europe, designed to influence local countries, they did a number of shows on 5G. They introduced one segment by saying, "We want to tell you about this exciting new technology, 5G. There's just one problem. It may kill you." They argued that the increased frequencies of 5G could lead to brain tumors, impotence, Alzheimer's, hair loss, I'm not sure which would be the worst. And what happened is what we've seen happen in so many other campaigns with social media, that it starts in the media, the information, but then it gets picked up by crazies on Facebook, social media, websites, and all of a sudden the original source can withdraw their fingerprints and disappear into the background. What this is with 5G is nothing more than a bald-faced attempt to make people afraid, to get parents to start protesting and getting court injunctions when 5G towers are built in their neighborhood, to make people try to ensure that a technology that you must have to be competitive in the 21st century is stalled or retarded. We've always seen this before. The media and propaganda have always been the media and government propaganda have always been the sources of disinformation and started the process, and then it gets picked up by word of mouth. The problem is today, word of mouth has become weaponized. The media has become the fuse that starts this whole process, but it's social media that's become the explosive. And this has become a really dangerous situation with no end in sight. And sadly, the social media companies who continue to make so much money off of this, to the point where Mark Zuckerberg alternates between being the third or fourth richest man in the world, have shown very little interest in looking at regulation, sharing what their problems are, or trying to fix the situation. What we've come to is full circle. What Facebook and other social media companies need to do, it's time to not move fast and break things, but slow down and fix things. Thank you very, very much.